it's Friday evening, coming home from work, and I have this great idea to make like this little application about omelets. Let's say it's omelets. And I have a lot of ideas in my mind about how it will look, how you will interact with it. And it's going to be on Android, and it's going to be on iPhone, it's going to be a browser. And I have all these ideas. I see a lot of wireframes and buttons, touch gestures. My dopamine is high. I feel very happy about my cool little app. And then I started thinking, OK, but if I'm going to put it on mobile and sell it, I think I'm going to need some sort of backend. Maybe some REST API would be OK. Should I make it in Node? Should I make it in .NET? OK, but where will I put it? Let's say I rent a server. Maybe I should set up a virtual machine. But how do I do that? I don't want to do the application anymore. But then my good friend Gabi comes and slaps me on the head and says, why don't you use serverless? It's easy. So welcome to our little presentation about Azure Functions and little getting started into Azure Functions and why you should use it. It's a topic pretty new to us as well, and we'd like to raise awareness about it because it's very cool. So our agenda for today, we'll talk about what is serverless and with the focus on Azure Functions and what are the advantages and disadvantages. We'll talk a little bit about alternatives to Azure and then some interactive demos. That will be a surprise. So one misconception about serverless is that it means no servers. There is no such things. It actually means this. So bus plus fuzz. Now a little side slide. What's up with all these us? So in there are a lot of as a services, but let's talk about three. So we have infrastructure as a service, where everything up to and including virtualization is already provided to us, but and we have to handle the rest, like operating system, what kind of server you want to use, and so on. Then we have platform as a service, or PaaS, where, again, a little more is already provided to us and set up, but we still have to manage our data storage, our business logic, our authentication, how we're going to do it. And then we have BaaS, which is backend as a service. So backend as a service, which is a part of serverless, it replaces all the server side or the custom server side logic that we used to implement, and provides it as off the shelf components. So for example, you can have something like, give here some examples, like sockets, web sockets. For example, SignalAir, which is part in Azure. Something that a database in Azure, you can have Cosmos DB, you can have messaging queue like Service Bus or something for authentication that is again already provided to you, and you just only have to use it and configure like Active Directory and many others. So then we move to fuzz. So in my example, had to, besides the all the cool things that would be the client-side application and the business logic, we also have to manage the application layer and the server and all of this. And this should magically disappear somehow. And maybe Gabi can continue.
Okay, I will take over from here. Thanks, Mikna. So, as Mikna said, we have the BaaS, which is backend as a service. We replaced our services with off-the-shelf components, and now we need something for implementing the business logic. How do we do that? In the previous slide, you saw that in the traditional way, we have a server layer, we have our application layer, and then we have our operations, which is the logic of our application. So we transform the business logic into a function. So we move all our business logic and split it in smaller chunks and deploy them as functions, which are basically REST APIs. Now, as an example, how a function works, we have here what it is called an HTTP trigger function. The user makes a request, as you saw with the lightning bolt flowing, if you saw it. The request goes to the platform, Azure, in this case, is the platform. It's the FaaS platform. And a routing is made out of the box. We don't need to do anything for this to happen. The routing chooses the right function for our request and then triggers a temporary container where our function will be executed. After the function is executed, the container is destroyed and the output is provided to the user. This is how a function works.
So maybe you can show a short example in...
Yeah, sure. Okay,
then I will... Okay, it's different resolution. So I already have a function created, but if you want to create one, just gonna, it's a relatively easy step, but depending on Azure servers might take like a minute to deploy or 15 minutes. So I'm not gonna do it now. But I already have created a pre-made, an HTTP trigger, which is like the basicest function ever. And of course you can do it in Visual Studio and you won't see it here, but you can also create it here. This is in C#. You can also make them in Node. I also think Java, but it's preview. So this, I don't know if I have enough space on the screen. No. I can test it. It's at the bottom because I cannot see from here. And this is only just saying hello world or hello Azure, I don't know, depending on the input. I have to scroll down. It also have like a little terminal here to see the bugs, if I have any, and a little test interface. You can change here the parameter. And okay, I think this is the button. Measures. Okay. Did it change? Okay. And if the screen was bigger, I could also show you how you can change the code, but it's really hard. So I'm just gonna go back to the presentation.
So this example covers the second picture from the slide, the HTTP trigger. We can make any HTTP trigger, post, get, head, anything you want. And besides that, we have a time trigger, which can be associated with a cron job or a scheduled task. We have a Cosmos DB trigger. This means that when an entry is added to the database, we can have some code executed, or blob trigger, which works like a watcher on a directory, on a storage, And anytime we have a file in that directory, the function will consume it, and custom code can be executed. Okay, now we go to the advantages. There are two big advantages, reducing in cost and reduced lead time. For the cost part, we have a reduction of labor cost, no need to manage the infrastructure ourselves, no need to manage virtual machine, no need to manage operating systems, everything is out of the box. We can reduce infrastructure cost, this is what I just said. The labor cost means that the system administration people that handles the DevOps actually needed to manage our infrastructure, and increases scaling flexibility. We can scale as much as we can and as out as we want to, and we don't need to buy or rent hardware, physical hardware, virtual machines, or even physical hardware.
Yeah, and in that graph there, you can see, for example, that is like a more traditional example, where even if you have like a few times that processing is needed, you have to have constant uptime. But for functions, for serverless in general, it will scale up when needed, and when the resource is not used, you're just not going to consume anything.
Yes, basically what that means, you pay only for what you use. You use only, I don't know, a quarter of a second. You only pay for that quarter of a second. As you saw in the previous example with the HTTP trigger, the fast platform generates a container, executes the code, then dies. You only pay for that execution. You don't pay for anything else. And as Mihnea said in the graph, we see the red line is what we will have if we have a server that runs 24 hours, and the green ones are the function, and it only runs when it's called, when it's needed.
Yeah, so if you want to win Black Friday tomorrow and have a store, you need serverless.
Okay, and we have the reduced lead time. We have an agile way to go to market. Mihnea, can you?
Yeah, so what we want to say with this is that, first of all, you can easily go to any location around the world, because you just have to configure where your application are distributed and deployed, and it takes a few seconds. Okay, maybe a few minutes to propagate. And also, and that's also related to fast development, that it's easy to make updates, and you don't have to worry about deploying an entire application. You can maybe just update a function or a few functions and just deploy that function. And it's easier to make updates in production, which in large application can be a real hassle. So let's talk about disadvantages.
Okay, sure, but I want to add one more thing, but the advantages. Also to the lead time, to the go-to-market time. If you want to start small, you can start small and use only what you need, and increase your business and pay more and scale up as you need. And also, Azure and every platform that is available offers geolocation redundancy. You can have servers all across the world that do the same thing, and I think that's cool. You can make that. Okay, let's talk about disadvantages. We have infrastructural outsource, so we outsource our infrastructure. We don't have our servers located near us, so that means a loss of control. We don't have control over the hardware. We don't have control over the software. It's there. We don't have control over it. But that means that is a consequence of not needing to set a server. So it's a disadvantage caused by something that reduce our time in development and deployment.
Yeah, but also this, you depending how you look to it, because if you're a startup, you don't see this as a disadvantage because you don't want control, because you know your security sucks.
Yeah, sure, why not?
But if you have like a very big client and he's somewhat old school and worried, he doesn't want to have that there, he wants their own servers and so on, might be some discussion. And so vendor lock-in, okay, so now, for example, in what we presented here, we presented Azure Functions. If you want to move to Amazon, there it will not be that direct because the system are not that compatible. It also depends how you implement your business logic, of course, but you can just move it like you would be if it was a virtual machine that it runs the same on any platform, on Azure N or Amazon. So that's another minus, let's say.
Yeah, it's not impossible, but you will need some development time to make the switch from one platform to the other. So it is a disadvantage. There are security concerns when you have a traditional way of doing things. You often skip parts about security because they are already implemented. Not in the case of the serverless. You will have more to manage to make your application secure, to allow access only when is needed, and to whom is needed. So you need to prepare in advance for this and make steps, development, for to cover the security.
Okay, so startup latency, what does this mean? It means that because the has, as Gabi presented, because it has to create on demand that little container, and also the entire platforms add some little latency, but depending on use case might be a very, very small problem or not a problem at all. And you have to know from the start what you want to do, because maybe functions are not for your for your specific use case.
Okay, so in many cases this latency is not observable, and in most cases is ignorable also.
Debugging, yeah.
Okay, so we have debugging. We know it's a hassle to debug in an application in cloud. Azure offers some support for it, for remote debugging. But this disadvantage can be covered by putting very many log lines in our application. And using that, we can debug easily. So we cannot attach, or we can attach to some services and run step by step in the application and see what is wrong. But for function, it's like beta stage, let's say. But as I said, we can counter this by using a lot of logs.
And we're talking about debugging in the cloud, not on our computer, because we all know it works on my machine. Right. And next, okay. So, by the way, we do not work for Microsoft. So, there are also alternatives, and I think Amazon is by far the most popular.
Yes,
it's
the leading option in serverless.
And I don't know if Azure is the second or third.
I think it's the third. It's Google Cloud, the second spot. We have Azure on the third, and IBM Cloud on the fourth. There are many, many others services that offer this, but they are not so known as those four,
yes,
including Azure.
Azure offers Lambdas, and Google Cloud, I think, has Cloud Functions, and I don't know, IBM has some of their thing, but
I don't know why they don't use IBM Cloud.
We just need to put a third one there.
Who uses IBM Cloud? Okay, so now the fun part. We have two.
An,
we prepare two applications, two interactive applications. Some quick overview of those demos. We use five of Azure functions. We can see them over there. We have chat, chat history, draw, email, and negotiate. If you want, I can go into details. We have one Signaler service and one Cosmos DB with two document bases. So now, if you want, you can follow this link on your mobile phone, and you can use the application to have fun. And meantime, we can answer your questions.
Where is it? So everybody's using portrait mode.
Okay, it's not very clear what people are trying, but
yes. But by the way, the good part is that this is stateless, and you can always refresh.
Yes, this is the first
and
application.
And remove everything.
Every user has a different color, so you can see yourself here.
So, oh my God.
We made those demos applications. This is the first. This is stateless. We don't store any draw anywhere. So if we refresh or someone enters after, he won't see the drawings. Okay, we can enter on the second application from the top left corner. You can click on the 3-4 lines, and we will see a chat.
Now this is going to be interesting.
Okay, so this application is stateful. All the messages are stored. So, okay. So, both of those applications are made using Azure Functions.
Okay. Should I stop it? Okay, anyway, if you want access to the... you can use it on the phone between you. So if you want access to the code and also to the presentation, just enter an email here.
Okay, so if you want access to the code, we can we will upload it to...
Or don't.
On Git repository, on GitHub. And we'll send you a mail when this will be uploaded along with the presentation. If you want to put your email address, everyone will receive a link with the presentation and the code. That's it for us. I hope that you will have fun with the chat.
People are still using this.
And we can answer any question if you have. No one?
I think they want to talk with you via chat.
Good luck with that.
No.
Okay, then, if there are no any questions.
Okay, I was almost
only
sure
answers,
about that.
Only answers, yeah. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.